Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to everybody. My name's Grant, and I'll be leading you through the service today. We continue on with our series, which is Living a Resurrection Life, and Trevor's going to bring us the sermon today. Dave, as you know, is away on break for the month of May, so we're filling in as best we can. So while he's away, if you do have any questions, then you direct them to Trevor or email the office. But it's awesome to have you here today. Just a quick reminder to remain vigilant about the COVID safe protocols that we have here with the minimum spacing, 1.5, things like that. If you're new here, we don't do morning tea after the service like we used to, but we do go across to the Civic Centre straight after the service. So if you want to join us, you're most welcome to come. They have all their COVID safe protocols in place for eating together. So they essentially have a reserved table for us. So just after the service, minimum mingling, as they say. So just move on across and we can continue on meeting together after the service. To start the service off, let's say these words of Psalm 92 together. They're on the screen. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Lord Most High, to declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your works. At the works of your hands I sing for joy. Let's stand as we sing our first song together, Christ, our hope in life and death.
Destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when
seat. Have a seat. Let's join in this Thanksgiving prayer together. Almighty God, Creator and Redeemer, we praise you for the beauty of the world around us and for every gift we enjoy. Thank you for creating us to know you, to love you, and to obey you. Most of all, we praise you for your amazing love in sending your Son to restore your world by dying for us and rising to give us new life, and for sending your life-giving Spirit. Accept our praise and thanksgiving through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right, we're going to go into a time for the kids. Before Peter and Wendy take them out to Sunday Kids, we're going to join in the kids' song, which will be up on the screen. Normally we have Dave playing music, singing away, banging that guitar, but as he's away, it's just music on the screen. So be praying as well for more musicians. If you have any musical ability, I'm sure Dave would love for you to join him. I would love to join him, but I'm absolutely hopeless. I've been learning guitar for 2 years, and they say just by looking at it doesn't make you learn it, but I have good intentions. Anyway, we'll join with this song, and then the kids will go out with Peter and Wendy.
Keep us day and night. We can. Yeah, I'll just pray before we do the Bible reading. Gracious God, your word is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. Today, when we hear your voice, deliver us from hardness of heart. Help us to put away everything that keeps us from persevering in your way. For the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So the first Bible reading is John 15, 9 to 17. John 15, 9 to 17. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I've kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because servants do not know their master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. The next reading is Ephesians 4, 17 to 25. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality, and so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learnt. When you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus, you were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbour, for we are all members of one body.
Well, good morning. We're a bit depleted this morning on Mother's Day, aren't we? Anyway, we're here to hear what God has to say. I'm going to pray. Heavenly Father, thank you very much for your word. We pray that your word will be a living word to us as we listen to it, and we pray that you'll give us the grace to put into practice what we hear, for Christ's sake. Amen. What we're doing through May, particularly at this service, is going through a service about living the resurrection life. We did look after Easter about four incidents where people met the risen Jesus. Now we're looking at the implications of that for our daily living. Dave will be back to preach the final sermon, but he's on holidays and I hope he's enjoying himself, and I hope the rain has eased and he can get out and do whatever he likes to do. So I'm here this morning, I'll be here next week and the week after, so that we will maintain continuity in this teaching series. A few weeks ago, I used a political illustration, always dangerous, but they're good illustrations because politicians regularly often say one thing but mean another. I don't know whether it was this service or another service, I'm sorry, I've been at so many services lately, but Earl Long, a former eccentric governor of Louisiana, once said of his colleague, "You know how you can tell that fella's lying? Watch his lips. If they're moving, he's lying." Politicians are easy targets because their words are recorded and can be played back. I'm old enough to remember when the late President Richard Nixon's secret conversations were published during the Watergate crisis, a long time ago now. He was revealed to be foul-mouthed, deceptive, and desperate to stay at the top at all costs. And in the end, he was impeached and removed from office. In the past month, it's been confirmed that a former New South Wales government minister will remain in jail for serious offences against minors. Part of the evidence used to convict him included secret police phone taps that revealed he'd been living a lie. But it can be far too easy to point the finger at the politicians. How would we fare if our words were played back? Are our words true and reliable, or false and unreliable? That's a serious question. Last week, when Dave preached, we saw that the daily motto of those who have died and been raised with Christ is to put off the old self-centered life and to put on the new Christ-centered life. If we're in Christ by faith, as we heard in the reading, the first part of the reading, we are to seek daily renewal as we yield to the transforming work of God's Spirit. Remember the startling imagery in this passage, which we'll see week after week, is the imagery of discarding old clothes. I, in my sermon last week, talked about the old dirty work clothes I wear when I'm mowing the lawn in this humid environment and how I put them out in the clothes bin at the end and have a nice cool shower and change so I'm fit for the evening. Paul uses that imagery of discarding old clothes and putting on a new suit, which he says is marked by righteousness and holiness. And the very first application of that principle is in the area of speech. Next week we'll look at the area of anger. A week after we'll look at something different, and we'll end up looking at relationships, because this is a profound exposition of what it means to put off the old way of life and to put on the new, because we're resurrected people. And the very first application is found in verse 25. Therefore, in the translation that I have, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbour, for we're all members of one body. Now, I listened to Les at the first service, and his was full of detail and all over the scripture. I'm coming to one verse. There's a negative to discard, a positive to put on, and a theological reason or incentive for the change. Just 3 points. What's the negative to discard? Well, we must put off falsehood. The text, by the way, is in the middle of the wavelength if you want to watch it. But you don't have to, because I think it'll be pretty simple. We are to put off falsehood. Literally, the lie. And it should be no surprise that lying heads this list that we're beginning to look at today. God is truth in his innermost being, and he himself cannot lie. That's what the apostle says in Titus. To lie would contradict his very nature, and he cannot deny himself. Moreover, the Bible describes his archenemy as the father of lies. All this is true. But in the context, it is the context which demands it come first. Because he has been reflecting earlier in this chapter about the unity of the church and the purity of the church. And he says in chapter 4, verse 15, before we get to the text that was read today, one of the keys to the unity of the church is speaking the truth in love. One of the keys to the purity of the church is being enrolled in the school of truth that is in Jesus. So lying is to be discarded like dirty or worn out clothing. Now, as I thought about this during the week, lying can take many forms. When we're young, we use it as a defensive weapon against parents or teachers. We learn to use it to protect ourselves, to escape punishment. It may take the form of an out and out lie or the proverbial whopper. The classic example in Scripture is the feeble excuse, in my opinion, offered by Aaron in Exodus 32:24, when the infamous golden cow incident, when that was unveiled. When confronted with the obvious evidence of his crime, he lamely offered the following excuse. So I told them, whoever has any gold jewelry, take it off. Then they gave me the gold, and I threw it into the fire, and out came this calf. However, we soon learned that whoppers are quickly detected. So we resort to subtler techniques. We learn it's better to tell just half the story. Because as Alfred Lord Tennyson wrote in his poem, The Grandmother, quote, he said likewise that a lie which is half the truth is ever the blackest of lies, that a lie which is all a lie may be met and fought with outright, but a lie which is part of the truth is a harder matter to fight. But there are other techniques. We can tell the story so we appear in a good light. We develop an incredible ability to make excuses for not doing or for doing something. Moreover, when we're really polished at the art, we can lie by simply saying nothing at all, and so leave people with the impression that we are virtuous or that nothing is wrong with a proposed course of action. In addition, the lie can invade the church fellowship in many forms. We can promise to pray for someone but not do it. The sharing of prayer points, on the other hand, can be an occasion for breach of confidence. In fact, gossip is tantamount to lying because the gossip is seldom in possession of the full facts. And those of us who ever played the game of China's whispers know how messages get distorted anyway. So when we indulge in passing on gossip we have heard, we are inevitably peddling half-truths. We can also exaggerate our spiritual performance. As a bishop, one of my pet hates used to be clergy who were always speaking about the numbers of people being converted all the time in their ministry units when I knew the numbers weren't going up at all in any way. We can use flattery to curry favour. We can vow a pledge but not keep it. Anyone who's organised a church camp or dinner will know what I mean when people who've made a commitment to come don't come and then also don't pay. I found that out when I was organising clergy conferences in the Diocese of Cameron Goldman. It applied to clergy as well. There are, however, subtler falsehoods, like giving people false comfort or hope supposedly based on the scriptures. Read Jeremiah 7 at some stage. Or rebuking someone who doesn't deserve it. Think about what happened to poor Job in his experience. The list is endless. And we could do well to remember God's perspective, recorded in Proverbs chapter 6. There are six things, the proverb writer says, the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies, and a man who stirs up dissensions among brothers. There is a negative to discard, which takes many, many evil forms. However, secondly, there is a positive to put on. Each of you, Paul says, must put off falsehood, the lie, and speak truthfully to your neighbour. We are to speak truthfully to one another. For those who have got Bibles and like to follow footnotes, this is a quote from Zechariah chapter 8, verse 16, where the people of God, restored from exile, were charged to behave in such a way so as to receive God's blessing rather than incurring his wrath as their fathers had done. The remnant of God's people living in Jerusalem, which is to be called a city of truth, was to be characterized by truth and righteousness and holiness. And Paul applies that Old Testament text to the new community in Christ in Ephesus. Obviously, the stability and health of any community depends on the degree to which people are truthful to one another. We all know how neighborly relations can be destroyed if someone holds a grudge and refuses to share how they feel. I can remember many years ago now my parents receiving a complaint from the local council about their dog barking. It was the first they realised there was a problem. It was a problem to someone else. They tracked the complaint down eventually to one person in the street who would typically complain to everyone else but not talk to them. We are to speak truthfully, Paul says, to our neighbours, and not about them to others. Many years ago too, I remember a movie caught my attention. This is a remarkable thing actually, because in one sense, entertainment, in a real sense, entertainment is my weakest area in trivial pursuit. If you want to play with me, you'll win all the time if you choose entertainment. The movie, and I don't know if you saw it, I'm a bit older than some of you, the movie was called Liar, Liar. It had Jim Carrey in it. While the lead actor is often repulsive, the plot was intriguing. It centered on a lawyer who, because of a birthday wish to his son, could not tell a lie for a whole day. And he constantly found himself forced to speak truthfully in every situation, revealing to the audience how we all unconsciously lie throughout the day. At one point, Jim Perry pleaded with his son to unwish his birthday wish, claiming, "I can't survive in my job if I have to tell the truth." Well, the Christian should be a person who speaks the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Our yes should be yes, and our no should be no. We are meant to be thoroughly reliable and dependable. Yet the command to put away falsehood and tell the truth is not carte blanche to disseminate that which is hurtful. According to Ephesians 4:15, which we haven't read, which I've referred to, truth is always to be modified by love. The new wardrobe of Christ's righteousness is given by grace, and grace and love are to be its hallmarks. This means, according to one classical ethical dilemma, that if a person comes to my door brandishing a gun and announces he will shoot my spouse the moment he finds her, that I don't tell the truth and say where she is. Common sense and love, both to her and to him, dictate that I say nothing about her whereabouts. Common sense and love demand I call the police. If you want a scriptural example of this, look at what Rahab did when she sheltered the spies back in the book of Joshua. She did exactly that. She didn't say where they were because she had a duty out of love to protect them. It would also be an uncharitable form of truthfulness to say what we really thought to a doting and proud parent about their small child's appalling musical rendition, or to say to Grant's spouse that he's hopeless at the guitar. This is the dilemma of every married couple. When your spouse asks you whether you will love her when she is old and wrinkled, then unless you are completely mad and deluded, you don't answer with a blunt, "I do." The truth needs to be spoken with love. Because love without truth is sickly sentimentality, but truth without love is harsh judgmentalism. Nonetheless, the followers of Jesus ought to be known as honest, reliable people whose word can be trusted. Moreover, if we're going to speak truthfully to our neighbour, we will need to seek God's help to say things to one another which are consistent with the truth of the gospel we have received and believed. Truth must always be measured against that objective standard. Discard the lie. Speak truthfully to one another. Why? Notice the text. We are all members of one body. The reason given for putting off falsehood and putting on truthfulness is we are all members of one another. And the context reminds us that Paul is referring to our membership of the body of Christ. That's what's been on focus in this chapter. The unity of the body of Christ, the purity of the body of Christ. And that truth has been mentioned in a number of places in this letter. Chapter 1, verse 23, chapter 4, verse 4. But in particular, he wrote this, and I'm going to go back to this text again. In chapter 4, verses 15 to 16, he says, "Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. We're all essential in the body of Christ. The health depends upon every member playing their part. Christ is the head. We are his members. If our human bodies rely for their safety on receiving true messages from our ears and our eyes and passing them onto our hands and our feet, then how much more does the church need to be marked by honesty and truth among its members? Just as it would be unthinkable for the eye to see danger and not inform the foot to run, or the mouth to taste something bitter but swallow it anyway, so also when one part of the body of Christ sees that which will damage the other, truth must be spoken. Ultimately, fellowship is built on trust, as any married couple knows. But trust depends on truth. Deception destroys relationships. Deception also destroys community. So in this gathering of God's people, who are the friends of Jesus by faith, we will only be able to cooperate together for the common good if we discern that we are the body of Christ and all our dealings will be marked by honesty, sincerity, integrity, and truth, qualified by love. Let me conclude. This is a very uncomfortable message for me to preach, because unlike many of you, I've earned my living by talking for the last 42 years. The reason I know so much about lying is because I'm very conscious of my own failures. But I suspect, and in fact I know, that I'm not alone in my failure in speech. Human beings lie to escape punishment, to impress other people, to please ourselves, and sometimes even in the church, to get revenge. Wherever the lie rears its ugly head in our lives, we need to discard it. Off with the old, on with the new. We need to go back to the cross of Christ for forgiveness and mercy, and seek the help of the Spirit to change. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But we need also to ask God's Spirit to help us to change such destructive habits. This then is the first example of the old life which must be discarded each day like a worn out, useless piece of clothing. Proverbs 18:21 says this: with a word we can give life, with a word we can bring death. Let us seek God's help, not to keep on abusing our mouths by lying in its many forms. Let us instead seek the help of God's Spirit to use our words for his purposes and speak the truth in love so that Christ's body here will grow to maturity. Our daily motto is, off with the old and on with the new. Because as our text says, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbour, for we are all members of one body. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, this is an uncomfortable message to hear from your word, because we are conscious of the way that we have failed. Please forgive us, and please change us. And may this body of Christ be marked by truth-telling in love, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Thank you. Give me an undivided heart, that I might fear your name. Teach me to walk in righteous paths and follow in your way. For you are gracious and forgiving. Hear, O Lord, and answer me. Give me an undivided mind, that I might love your word. Help me to hunger for your voice and know your spirit soar. For you are good, your truth unchanging. Life is found in serving you.
Going to continue responding to God's word, not just with song, but with prayers and confession, and also if the faith in Jesus is, if that's what you believe, then we'll share this affirmation of faith together with these words on the screen. We say it together. Jesus Christ, in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. We've come together to meet with God and to take our part in the building of his church. Christ himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds we have been healed. Let us acknowledge our failure to serve him as he deserves and return to the Lord with repentance and faith as we pray this confession together. Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love, but we have often gone our own way and rejected your will for our lives. We are sorry for our sins and turn away from them. For the sake of your Son who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us, and change us. By your Holy Spirit, enable us to live for you and to please you in every way. For the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm just going to invite Nathan up to continue with prayer. Thanks.
Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you're all-knowing, that you're all-powerful, and by your will, things come and go. Lord, we thank you for the forgiveness found through your Son, Jesus. Help us, Lord, to live each day in service to you, acknowledging the grace you have given us. Help us to freely pass that on to other people and love them into the kingdom, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that this is the day you have made. Let us rejoice, Lord, and be glad with it. We thank you, Lord, that we have this day to celebrate mothers who nurture our children, who bring a whole element into the family unit, Lord. Lord, we pray for the mothers out there that you would guide them, you'd care for them, love them, and you'd help them in their task in the family home, in serving you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for Ross and Leanne. We thank you for the 10-plus years of faithful service they've had at Milton Ulladulla. Lord, we just continue to keep Ross in prayer for his health. We pray to you, Father, during this break he'd be able to recover. Lord, we pray for what's ahead for them. And we think of them, Lord, each day, and thank you for the service they have given to your people. Lord, we think of other people in our congregation, Lord, who have undergone surgery, such as Frank G with his heart surgery. Lord, we ask that you'd just help him, Lord, with his recovery. Give him strength, Lord. Just help him to remind him, Lord, that you love him just as he loves you. We thank you for Marion Gabbett, Lord, and we pray, dear Father, for her as she's been diagnosed with ovarian cancer. Lord, we thank you that doctors were able to eradicate a lot of the cancer already with treatment, but we do understand further retreatment is required. So we ask, dear Father, that you'd continue to nurture her, to care for her, to love her, and that she may feel the love of the church around her in supporting her through this time. Lord, we know your word says how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news, proclaiming peace and your salvation. When we think of the missionaries linked with this church, Lord, we think of Miriam Bradshaw in Spain, and Joseph and Danica in Mexico serving with YM. We think of Liz Bennett up in Newcastle with YM, Lord. We thank you for their obedience in taking the calling you've given them, Lord. And we pray to you, Father, that we have fruit from their ministry that may multiply in bringing people into your kingdom. Lord, we think of Burrell Pines down there on the south coast of Burrell Lake, Lord. We pray for opportunity amongst staff there to speak words of life into people's lives. Lord, we thank you for the relational ministry we have down there. We pray to you, Father, that you would go before us and that you'd provide opportunities for us to engage with people in your word, Lord. Lord, we think of Dave on holidays and we thank you for him. We thank you for his service and we thank you for all he does in this church. We pray to you, Father, you'll give him a time of refreshment a time to enjoy your word for his own spiritual growth and a time of relaxation, Lord. Lord, we give these prayers to you, Lord, knowing that you are able, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I thought there might have been a special prayer in there, Nathan, for Roscoe as well this week for his favourite football team going down 50-0. He'd be stressing big time on that. But I just want to, we'll continue praying as well for all those that do give electronically. We certainly thank you for that. If you, we don't pass the plates around anymore because of COVID, so if you do want to give, the envelopes or cash, there is a box at the back as you leave, and I'll just pray for that now. Heavenly Father, thank you that we do have these gifts to share. We thank you so much for the life you give us here in Ulladulla. Help us to be generous in what you've given to us that we can share with others, not only in the support of spreading the gospel, supporting this place, the ministers, but also for the finances that we give for those that care in need, the people who are struggling just with the daily basics. Help us to be generous in everything we do, not only with our money, but also with our time. But we certainly thank you for what's been given today, and we thank it in Jesus' name. Amen. And we'll finish our time of prayer with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I'm just going to invite Becky up to bring the announcements.
Hello. Okay, just a couple announcements that I want to draw your attention to in the wavelength. I just wanted to, because we were talking about Beryl Pines in the prayer, there is a Christian Surfers get-together, a festival on May 22nd. It's called Swell Times. There's actually a website called swelltimes.com.au. Details are in the wavelength, but it's going to be a day event, but you can stay the whole weekend, and it's just going to be a gathering of not just surfing, but arts and crafts and workshops and storytelling and all sorts of wonderful things. So you might like to pop that in your calendar, and that's at Beryl Pines, who are always opening their doors for opportunities to connect with the community and share the gospel. There is going to be a new archbishop. The synod has unanimously agreed that the very Reverend Kanishka Raphael is invited to be the Archbishop of Sydney. And that inauguration is going to be on the 28th of May. So please pray for the Archbishop-elect, as he waits and prepares for his role. I would love to know what the very Reverend means. Is that a special thing, or am I the only one who doesn't know what that means? I felt like I needed to say it because it was written.
Sister, we're a strange organization which has got a long history. And so archbishops are called Most Reverend. Bishops are called Right Reverend. Deans are called Very Reverend, and archdeacons are called Venerable. Is that helpful for you?
Okay.
It's just an ancient custom, and I really don't know when it began. I just know that it's happened for hundreds of years, and when you try to change something which has happened for hundreds of years, then you sometimes get difficulty. Grant asked me beforehand, do I call you Bishop Trevor? I said, just call me Trevor, because that's my name. Just because I have a particular office doesn't mean...
Yeah.
But actually, it's a very significant event, and because it's the first time a non-Anglo has been elected as the Archbishop of Sydney. He Kanishka has an interesting story. He was born of Sri Lankan parents in London. They came to Australia. His father died. He went back to Sri Lanka for a little while, then came back to Australia. And he was studying arts and law at Sydney University in the 1980s. A fellow student, here's an encouragement for you, a fellow student gave him a copy of John's Gospel. And he read it, and he was converted from Buddhism to a firm believer in Jesus. He served as a curate at the church where I served in Canberra before I came. He served for 16 years in the Diocese of Perth before he came to be dean. So he's had a lot of experience outside of Sydney and in the national church. And in their wisdom, the synod have elected him to be the archbishop. Please pray for him. He's never been a bishop before, so he'll be on a steep learning curve. And also steep learning curve as an archbishop, which means he has responsibility for all of New South Wales as well. Not there are individual bishops in different places, but he has a responsibility to care for them and to see that the ministry of the gospel goes forward right across the state.
Great. Well, thank you so much for giving us that extra information, a lot more than I knew. So there you go. Very means he was a dean. Okay, and there is going to be a farewell to our wonderful Ross and Leanne Maltman. There are a lot of details in the wavelength. I'm not going to read every single one of them, but please definitely maybe take that home, pop it on your fridge, take a picture with your phone. I guess if you regularly want to come to St. Martin's, the service will be at 11 a.m., and this is on Sunday, the 6th of June. There is going to be a lunch following. There's a cost and, you know, details on how, you know, a little bit about that, and then if you would like to contribute to a farewell gift. So at the bottom it says, what do I need to do? You need to plan for the special times for the service and attend if you're going to. You're going to register for lunch and then decide if you'd like to put a contribution towards the gift. You're going to put that in an envelope marked farewell gift and place it in the offertory box, which is at the back there. If you're wondering where the hole is to the offertory box, it's under the sign, so if you can't find it, could be a little confusing. Okay, and we've got a note from Trevor in there as well that you can read, and we've already mentioned that Dave's on vacation. May he have a wonderful time, refreshing time. And church rosters are now available in the church entry area, having a little glitch with the computer system, so hard copies are there. Okay, thanks everybody. Oh, and can I just mention there will be cafe after church at Civic Center Cafe. There's not a lot of us here. Ro has just booked the big table. You're welcome to go and enjoy each other's company. Okay.
Further to that as well, there's also an article in the Sydney Morning Herald today on the Archbishop. So it's not just church news; it's actual. It's across the state, so it is a wonderful story, and it's amazing how he's only been. Well, he's actually an Archbishop elect, and they're onto him already, and I feel like he answers the questions very well. So it's worth a read. And keeping him definitely in your prayers, I feel like that would be some task of a job. Let me just say this concluding prayer before we share the grace together. Gracious God, you made an eternal covenant with us through the blood of your Son, and you brought him back from the dead as the great shepherd of your sheep. Equip us with everything good for doing your will. Work in us what is pleasing to you. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And the grace, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Two different versions there, that's hard. I almost got through it without making it blue, but that's pretty good. Almost there. Anyway, have a great Sunday. Happy Mother's Day. And if you'd like to join us over at the Civic Center, we'd love to see you there. Thanks.
song. She's seven and she sings along. The words just keep on spinning through her mind. Later on that very day, in a precious, deep and simple way, she calls to Jesus, come into my life. Exchange the joy of heaven for the